Sri Gurubhyo Nama children, welcome to online class. Yesterday we have completed about the we have seen about the major food crops grown in our country. I have started with rice and wheat yesterday, and we have seen the climatic conditions required. We have seen the temperature, rainfall, areas where rice cultivation is carried over, and areas where wheat cultivation is carried over, and the climatic conditions required for wheat, whether it is a rabi crop or kharif crop, everything we have seen in detail yesterday. Today I am going to start with millets. So the topic for today is millets in agriculture. So millets, the two important characteristic features of millets are, so millets, they are coarse grains. So roughly, when you see the appearance of millets, it will be roughy in nature. So rough appearance, coarse grains. The next one, it has got the highly nutritive value. It has got high nutrition value. So that the characteristic features are, millets are nothing but they are coarse grains. The second one, it has got high nutritive value. Now we are going to talk about the important millets that are grown in our country. So first I told about the features of millets. They are coarse grains and highly nutritive. The next we are going to see the important millets that are grown in our country. The first one is ragi. The first important millet is ragi, which is grown in our country. So we are going to discuss the features of ragi. So when you talk about ragi, it is rich in iron, calcium, micronutrients and roughage. So it is rich in iron, calcium, micronutrients and roughage. Next, when you talk about the regions where it is cultivated, so it grows in dry regions. So even in dry regions we can see the ragi cultivation. Next, we are going to talk about the soils that are suitable for ragi cultivation. It can be grown very well in red, black, sandy and loamy soils. So the soil content should be, it can be a red soil, it can be a black soil, sandy soil and loamy soil. Next, when you talk about the largest producing state, so when we are discussing about ragi now, so Karnataka is the largest producer of ragi, followed by Tamil Nadu. So when you talk about the largest producing state, Karnataka is the largest producing state of ragi, followed by Tamil Nadu. And even in other states, ragi can be cultivated. For example, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, etc. So once again, we are going to see about millets. So millets are nothing but coarse grains and they are highly nutritive. And the important millets that are grown in our country are ragi, jowar and bajra. And to start with, we are going to discuss about ragi. When you talk about ragi, it is rich in iron, calcium, micronutrients and roughage. When you talk about the growth of the ragi, when you talk about the cultivation of ragi, even in dry regions, we can see the ragi cultivation. And the soil which are suitable for ragi cultivation is red soil, black soil, yellow loamy soil and sandy soil. When you talk about the largest producing state, Karnataka is the largest producing state of ragi, followed by Tamil Nadu. Other important states of ragi cultivation are Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, etc. Next, we are going to talk about jowar. Jowar is also another important millet that is grown in our country. When you talk about jowar, it is a rain-fed crop. So particularly, it grows in moist areas. As it is a rain-fed crop, so it grows in moist areas which hardly requires irrigation. So moisture is required, so it is a rain-fed crop, moisture is required, so hardly needs irrigation. When you talk about the largest producing state, Maharashtra is the largest producing state of jowar, followed by Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. So jowar is also another important millet so grown in our country. It is a rain-fed crop. Moreover, it grows well in moist areas, so where irrigation is hardly needed. When you talk about the largest producing state, Maharashtra is the largest producing state of jowar, followed by Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. The next one, we are going to talk about bajra. Bajra is also another important millet that is grown in our country. So when you talk about the soil nature, so it grows very well in sandy soil, shallow black soil. So the soil suitable for bajra cultivation is sandy soil as well as the black soil. Shallow black soil is suitable. The next one, when you talk about the largest producing state, Rajasthan is the largest producing state of bajra. So Rajasthan is the largest producer of bajra, followed by Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat and Haryana. So Rajasthan is the largest producer, followed by Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat and Haryana. So once again I'll repeat, jowar and bajra. Jowar, it is a rain fed crop. So we can see in moist areas where irrigation is hardly required. Next, Maharashtra is the largest producer of jowar, followed by Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. The next important millet is bajra. Bajra grows well in sandy soil and shallow black soil. So it grows well in sandy soil as well as in shallow black soil. When you talk about the largest production, Rajasthan is the largest producer of bajra, followed by Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat and Haryana. The next one, we are going to talk about maize. Maize is a food crop as well as fodder crop. So it can be grown as a food crop, it can be given as a fodder crop for animals, and it is a kharif crop. Already we have seen about rabi, kharif and zayad. And when you talk about maize, it is a food crop as well as a fodder crop. When you talk about the nature, it is a kharif crop, that is it grows on the onset of monsoon and is cultivated between April to June. Next, temperature requirement is 21 to 27 degrees Celsius. So, temperature requirement for maize cultivation is 21 degree to 27 degrees Celsius. And when you talk about the soil nature, it grows very well in old alluvial soil. So, the soil nature should be old alluvial soil. And increased production is possible for this crop by HYV seeds, irrigation facilities and fertilizers. Increased production is possible for this crop by HYV seeds, chemical fertilizers and irrigation facilities. When you talk about the maize producing states, Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. The important states are Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. So once again we will discuss maize. So it is a food crop as well as a fodder crop. And it is a kharif crop also, where the temperature requirement is 21 degrees Celsius to 27 degrees Celsius. When you talk about the soil, it grows very well in old alluvial soil. The next one, increased production is possible for this crop by HYV seeds, chemical fertilizers and irrigation facilities. When you talk about the major maize producing states, Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. The next one, we are going to talk about pulses. So when you talk about our country, India is the largest producer and consumer of pulses. So when you talk about our country, we are the largest producers as well as consumers of pulses. When you talk about the nutritive value, it is rich in protein content. So it is rich in protein content. Important pulses that are grown in our country: Turad dal, urad dal, moong dal, peas, grams, etc. So when you talk about the major pulses that are grown in our country, we can talk about tur dal, urad dal, moong dal, peas, gram, etc. And when you talk about the nature, it grows well in less moisture and dry regions. Even in less moisture as well as in dry regions, we can see the cultivation of pulses. So it grows in less moisture areas as well as in dry regions. And one more important point, the leguminous plants, for example, peas and beans, which fixes the nitrogen in the soil, enriches the soil fertility for pulses. So the pulses enriches, it has got the greater enrichment because of the nitrogen fixing bacteria by the leguminous plants like peas, beans, etc. When you talk about the it can be grown as a rotation crop also. It can be grown as a rotate, can be cultivated with other crops also. The important pulses producing states are Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, etc. The important pulses producing states are Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, etc. So once again we are going to discuss about pulses. So pulses are nothing but in India we are the largest producer and consumer of pulses, and it has got high protein content. When you talk about the major pulses in our country, we are growing tur dal, urad dal, moong dal, peas, grams, etc. And it grows in less moisture region as well as in dry areas also. And already I told about the nitrogen fixing bacteria by leguminous plants like peas and beans enriches the soil fertility. The next one, it can be grown along with other crops also, rotation crops. The next one, the important pulses producing states are Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan. The next we are going to, so far we have discussed about the food crops. Now we are going to see food crop, that is crops other than grains. So food crops, so far we have discussed about the grains. We are going to talk about food crops other than grains. When you, in this topic, we are going to discuss about sugarcane. So, food crops other than grains, that is the topic. In this, we are going to discuss about sugarcane. So, when you talk about sugarcane, it grows well in tropical as well as subtropical climate. So, it grows well in tropical and subtropical climate. That's why, so it is a tropical crop as well as subtropical crop. So, hot and humid conditions are greatly required, as it is already clear in the first point that it grows well in tropical and subtropical climate. So, hot and humid conditions are required for its growth. When you talk about the temperature, it needs 21 degree to 27 degree Celsius. When you talk about the rainfall requirement for sugarcane cultivation, it is 75 cm to 100 cm. When you talk about the soil nature, it grows well in variety of soils. So, it grows well in any type of soil, variety of soils. The next one, manual labor is greatly needed for the sugarcane production. The next one, when you talk about the main source of sugarcane are sugar and gur. The main source of sugarcane are sugar and gur. When you talk about the largest producing state, and India, Brazil is the largest producer of sugarcane followed by India. The important states that grows sugarcane are Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu. Once again, we are going to see food crops other than grains. In this topic, I am going to discuss about sugarcane. So, sugarcane, it is a tropical as well as subtropical crop. That is, it grows well in tropical climate as well as subtropical climate. The next point is hot and humid conditions are required. So, hot and humid climate is greatly required. The third one is temperature requirement 21 degrees Celsius to 27 degrees Celsius. When you talk about the rainfall, it requires 75 to 100 centimeter rainfall, and it grows well in variety of soil. Manual labor is greatly needed for sugarcane cultivation. The next one, the main source of sugarcane is sugar and gur. When you talk about the, India is standing second place after Brazil. Brazil is the largest producer of sugarcane. So we are standing in the second place. And when you talk about the major sugarcane producing states, UP is the largest producer of sugarcane, followed by Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. Now we are going to discuss about oil seeds. When you talk about oil seeds, India is the largest producer of oil seeds. And we are going to see the major oil seeds that are produced in our country. So, I have started with the topic oil seeds. India is the largest producer of oil seeds. And we are going to see the major oil seeds that are produced in our country. Groundnuts, mustard, coconut, sesamum, soya bean, castor seeds, cotton seeds, linseed and sunflower. The important oil seeds that are grown in our country are groundnut, sesamum, coconut, mustard, soya bean, castor seeds, cotton seeds, linseed and sunflower. And when you talk about these oil seeds, it can be used as for edible purposes as well as for raw materials. So when you talk about the oil seeds, it can be used as edible as well as it can be used as a raw material in industry. And when you talk about the oil seeds, the most important oil seed is groundnut. So it is a kharif crop. So we are going to discuss about groundnut, which is a kharif crop. And when you talk about the largest producing state, so Andhra Pradesh is the largest producing state of groundnut, followed by Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Gujarat and Maharashtra. So when you talk about groundnut, it is a kharif crop, where the largest producing state is Andhra Pradesh, followed by Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Gujarat and Maharashtra. And the next one, we are going to talk about the plantation crops. So from the to start with, we are going to talk about tea. So when you talk about tea, it is a plantation crop. Already we have discussed about plantation crop. Plantation crop is nothing but a single crop is grown in the large area, in a particular field. A single crop is grown in the entire field. So we can call it as a plantation crop. So tea is a plantation crop. And it is a beverage crop also. So tea is a plantation crop, it is a beverage crop. This tea was initially introduced by British in India. So British only introduced tea in India. Now we can see many Indians who own tea estates in our country. And when you talk about the climatic conditions, it needs tropical and subtropical climate. So when you talk about the climatic conditions for tea, tropical and subtropical climate is greatly required. The next one, it needs well-drained fertile soil. So when you talk about the soil, it needs well-drained fertile soil. The next condition is, it should be frost-free all around the year. Frost-free days should be there all around the year. So that is another important condition. So the first condition is tropical and subtropical climate. The second condition is well-drained fertile soil. The third condition is frost-free all around the year. And when you talk about the labor availability, so greater number of laborers are required. So it is a labor-intensive crop. And when you talk about the processing nature, there will be a processing plant in the tea gardens. So a processing plant will be there in the tea gardens. Now we are going to see the important tea producing states. The important tea producing states are Assam, hilly regions of West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. So when you talk about the tea producing states, Assam, hilly regions of Assam, West Bengal, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. And India is the largest producer and exporter of tea. Once again, we are going to discuss about tea cultivation. So tea is a plantation crop. It is also a beverage crop. Tea was initially introduced by Indians, but now you can see many Indians who own tea estates in our country. And when you talk about the climate, it needs tropical and subtropical climate, and it requires well-drained fertile soil. The next condition is frost-free days all around the year. The next one, it is a labor-intensive crop, where we are going to engage more number of agricultural laborers. And there will be a tea processing plant in the garden. So as soon as the tea leaves are plucked, it will be processed in the garden. The next one, we are going to talk about coffee. And coffee, when you talk about coffee, it is also a plantation crop and beverage crop. So coffee is also a plantation crop and beverage crop. Nearly 4% of the coffee production is done in the world by our country. So nearly 4% of the coffee production is done by our country in the world. And when you talk about the Indian coffee is known for its quality. So Indian coffee is known for its quality. Arabica variety of coffee. So initially it is brought from Yemen, now it is produced in our country. Arabica variety of coffee initially brought from Yemen, now it is produced in our country. And when you talk about the coffee growing state, particularly the introduction we can see in the Baba Budan Hills in Karnataka. So Baba Budan Hills in Karnataka is famous for coffee cultivation. So once again, I am going to repeat, coffee is a plantation crop, it is also a beverage crop, and nearly 4% of the coffee production is done by our country in the world. And when you talk about the coffee quality, Indian coffee is well known for its quality. Arabica variety of coffee which is brought from Yemen initially. Now it is produced in our country. When you talk about the cotton producing, that is coffee producing states, particularly we can see Baba Budan Hills in Karnataka, which is famous for coffee cultivation. Next, we are going to talk about horticultural crops. How do you know that horticulture is nothing but producing fruits and vegetables? So we are going to discuss now about the horticultural crops in our country. So horticulture is nothing but producing fruits and vegetables. India is producing temperate as well as tropical fruits. So we are producing temperate fruits as well as tropical fruits, and we are going to see in detail now the various fruits that are produced in our country. The first one, mangoes. Mangoes are grown in Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal. So when you talk about mangoes, it is famous in Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal. When you talk about oranges, oranges are famous in Nagpur, Meghalaya and Cherrapunji. So when you talk about oranges, so it is famous in Meghalaya, Nagpur and Cherrapunji. And bananas, when you talk about bananas, Kerala, Mizoram, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. So bananas are famous in Kerala, Mizoram, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. And lychees and guava is also cultivated in our country. Lychees and guavas are also cultivated in our country. Particularly UP, that is Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, are famous for lychee and guava cultivation. So Uttar Pradesh and Bihar are famous for lychee and guava cultivation. And we have pineapples in our country, that is, it is produced in Meghalaya. So pineapples are produced in Meghalaya. Grapes also produced in our country by Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra. So when you talk about grapes, Maharashtra and Andhra Pradesh, they are good in grape cultivation. Apples, pears, apricots and walnuts. So when you talk about the other fruits, apples, pears, apart from that, apricots and walnuts also produced in our country. The important states are Jammu Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh. So apples, pears, apricots and walnuts, which are produced from Jammu Kashmir and Andhra Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh. Next, we are going to talk about vegetables. So apart from fruits, we are producing vegetables also in our country. So India produces nearly 13% of the world's vegetables. So India produces nearly 30% of the world's vegetables. For example, we are growing different types of vegetables in our country. So major vegetables that are grown in our country are peas, onion, cauliflower, brinjal, tomato and potato. The important vegetables that are grown in our country are peas, onion, cauliflower, brinjal, tomato and potato. Now we are going to discuss about non-food crops. To start with, I am going to discuss about rubber. Rubber is an equatorial crop. So it grows in tropical as well as subtropical conditions. So we are going to discuss about non-food crops. To start with, I am going to discuss about rubber. Rubber is an equatorial crop, so it grows also in tropical as well as subtropical conditions. And it needs moist and humid climate. So the climatical conditions are, it needs moist and humid climate. The next one, when you talk about the temperature, it needs the temperature above 25 degrees Celsius. So the temperature needed for rubber cultivation is above 25 degrees Celsius, and the rainfall is above 200 centimeter. So we need above 200 centimeter of rainfall for rubber cultivation. And when you talk about the rubber, the importance of rubber is, it is used as a industrial raw material. So it is used as a raw material in industries. So we can use it for rubber tubes, pipes, etc. And when you talk about the rubber producing states, Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So when you talk about the rubber producing state, the major rubber producing state is Kerala, followed by Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So rubber, which is a non-food crop, it is an equatorial crop. So it grows well in tropical and subtropical conditions. And when you talk about the climate, it needs moist and humid climate. It needs a temperature of above 25 degrees Celsius and rainfall above 200 centimeter. It acts as a raw material in industries. So we can use the rubber for making rubber tubes, rubber pipes, etc. Next, when you talk about the rubber producing states, Kerala is the largest producer of rubber, followed by Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. The next one, we are going to talk about fiber crafts. We are going to discuss about fiber crafts here, that is cotton, jute, hemp and silk. When you talk about the fiber crafts, we are going to discuss about cotton, jute, hemp and silk. When you talk about the first three, that is cotton, jute and hemp, are obtained from plants, so they are plant fibers, whereas silk is obtained from silkworm, so it is an animal fiber. The next one, rearing of silkworms for silk production is known as sericulture. So we are going to, once again I am going to talk about fiber crafts. So here we are going to discuss about cotton, jute, hemp and silk. So the first three, that is the cotton, jute and hemp, are obtained from plants, so it is a plant fiber, whereas silk is reared from silkworm, so it is an animal fiber. Rearing of silk for silk production is known as sericulture. The next one we are going to talk about cotton. The first one we are going to talk about the cotton, which is a fiber crop, which is a plant fiber. So cotton, it has been originated in India, so it is a kharif crop. So it is originated in India, so it is a kharif crop. When you talk about the raw material, so it is a raw material for industry. So it acts as a cotton, raw cotton, it is acting as a raw material for cotton textile industry. So cotton, it has an origin in India. Moreover, it is a kharif crop. It acts as a raw material, main raw material for industries. The third, India is the third largest producer in cotton textile industry. And when you talk about the conditions needed for cotton cultivation, it requires high temperature. So the climatic conditions are high temperatures, light rainfall is required, or irrigation facilities are needed. So it requires high temperature, light rainfall or irrigation facilities for its cultivation. And it needs 210 frost-free days. So it needs really 210 frost-free days for its cultivation. And bright sunshine is required for the cotton seeds. Next, the important states that grows cotton are Maharashtra, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. The important cotton growing states are Maharashtra, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. The next one we are going to talk about jute. So jute is also a plant fiber. It is called a golden fiber. So it is a golden fiber. So it is very costly, like gold, which is costly. Even jute is also costly. So it is a golden fiber and it requires well-drained fertile soil. So jute, it is a golden fiber. It requires well-drained fertile soil. And when you talk about the temperature, it requires high temperature for its cultivation. Next, the uses of jute are, it is used in making ropes, mats, gunny bags, etc. So jute is used for making ropes, mats and gunny bags, etc. And when you talk about this jute, it has, because of its high cost, it has got a great competition in the market. So jute has been replaced by artificial fibers like nylon, which is used in the industries now because of its low cost. When once again I am going to discuss about jute. So jute is also a plant fiber. It is a golden fiber because it is very costly. The next one, it requires well-drained fertile soil. High temperature is also required. It is used for making gunny bags, ropes, mats, etc. Because of the introduction of synthetic products in the market, it loses its popularity in the market. And when you talk about the synthetic products, particularly nylon, so nylon has been replaced jute from the market because of its low cost. The next one we are going to talk about Bhutan and Gramdan movement. So this Bhutan and Gramdan movement was initiated by Vinoba Bhave. So Vinoba Bhave has initiated this Bhutan and Gramdan movement. It is otherwise called as bloodless revolution. So the other, it is otherwise called as bloodless revolution. So initiated by Vinoba Bhave, it was called as bloodless revolution. And Vinoba Bhave, he was a disciple of Mahatma Gandhi. And when this Vinoba Bhave went for a Padayatra at Pochamballi in Andhra Pradesh. So this is a, this Vinoba Bhave, who was a disciple of Mahatma Gandhi, he went for a Padayatra at Pochamballi. And he met the poor landless peasants there. They demanded some lands for their economic growth. So, but he told that he will talk to the government and do the needful. Suddenly, Sri Ramachandra Reddy stood up and offered 80 acres of land to 80 landless peasants. And this act was called as Bhudan. So, once again I will repeat. Vinoba Bhave, when he was... He had a Padayatra at Pochamballi in Andhra Pradesh. He saw some landless peasants. And these landless peasants, they demanded some lands for their economic growth. And he promised them that he will talk to the government and do the needful. At that time, Sri Ramachandra Reddy offered 80 acres of land to 80 landless peasants. This act was called as Bhudan. Similarly, some zamindars, owners of many villages, they donated some villages to the poor people. Suddenly, some zamindars who were the owners of the villages, they donated some villages to the poor people. We can call this as Gramdan. So it is a Bhudan Gramdan movement. So initiated by Vinoba Bhave, it was a bloodless revolution. He was a disciple of Mahatma Gandhi. So when he went for a Padayatra at Pochamballi in Andhra Pradesh, he met the poor people. He met the poor people and he thought, and the poor people, they have demanded some lands for their economic welfare. He promised that he will talk to the government and do the needful. Suddenly, Sri Ramachandra Reddy contributed 80 acres of the land to the 80 landless peasants. This act was called as Bhudan Act. Similarly, some zamindars who were the owners of the lands in the villages, they donated some villages to the poor people. So we can call this as Gramdan movement. It is also called as a bloodless revolution. And we are going to talk about technological and institutional reforms introduced by the government for agricultural production, to increase the agricultural production. Technological and institutional reforms introduced by the government to increase the agricultural production in India. To start with, abolition of zamindari. Zamindari system has been completely abolished in order to increase the agricultural production. Next, consolidation of landholdings. The landholdings has been consolidated and so many land reforms have been taken in order to improve the agricultural production and cooperation. So these are, the first one is abolition of zamindari system. Second one is land reforms have been introduced. The third one is consolidation of landholdings and cooperation is greatly required. The next one, introduction of green revolution and white revolution. So production of food, green revolution, and white revolution, production of food and milk played a greater role. So it also increased the agricultural production. Minimum support price has been introduced by the government in order to protect the farmers from the speculators. The next one, crop insurance schemes were introduced for the farmers in order to they can get the insurance against droughts, floods, etc. The next one, Kisan credit cards were also introduced for the welfare of the farmers. Subsidies were given to the farmers for seeds as well as the agricultural inputs. Next, radio and television programs have been introduced for the farmers. Weather bulletins were given to the farmers. All these are the various technological institutional reforms. Once again, I will recollect. Abolition of zamindari, first one. Second point, consolidation of landholdings. The third point is land reforms were made. The fourth point, cooperation. The next one, introduction of green revolution, white revolution, which has increased the agricultural production. Minimum support price has been introduced by the government in order to protect the farmers from the speculators. Crop insurance schemes are introduced for the farmers so that they can get the insurance against droughts, floods, etc. Kisan credit cards were also introduced for the welfare of the farmers. Subsidies were introduced by the government for the seeds as well as for the agricultural inputs. Radio and television programs have been organized for the welfare of the farmers. The last one, weather bulletins were introduced so that they can get the information about the flood, about the rain, cyclone, etc.